do that to me, Ryan. Awesome. Great. Thank you, Ryan. Looking forward to his presentation. Again, that'd be 1 o'clock Central Time, where he will definitely cover OmniScans and may include a little bit of on the Rhino indicator. All right, folks. Well, it's a slow afternoon right now, but we'll keep our eye on the market. We'll alert you if we see something happen, including the important levels on the indexes or any trading opportunities that do arise. And we'll be back with you at a quarter till three Central Time in order to do our market wrap-up. Until then, best of luck with your trading this afternoon.
Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to the 1 o'clock hour central, or whatever time it is where you are. You have now joined the greatest show on earth right next to the circus, but you can't go there. So let's talk OmniScan. I'm Ryan. This is going to be a short, well, I'm planning on it being a kind of short presentation, but we'll see how it goes. And then I'll answer any questions as we go along. But this is going to go over some of the stuff that Angela went over last week, or maybe it was the week before that the video wasn't there. So we're going to cover some of it. There's been some questions about formulas inside of OmniScans, and then there's been some questions about going over trend pressure. We won't be covering the trend pressure because we just had a presentation yesterday about the trend pressure, and actually I moved it up here this morning. There is a presentation by Mark yesterday talking about the trend pressure, and we also have one on the education page from his first presentation. I'll get the new one over here as well, but I wanted to make sure it was up and quick. Let's see, trend pressure. So he covered extensively about that scan, the trend pressure up and down, so I will not be covering that. Now, for this OmniScan, it's going to be slightly more advanced than beginner, but it's not going to be professional grade either. So we're going to cover not only the functionality of OmniScan, we'll talk about some of the parameters and functions within OmniScan that you can use in your scans. And then we'll talk about how you can use scans that we've already created and build them more for your liking or for your purposes. So we're going to do this in OmniTrader. It's the same in OmniTrader and Visual Trader. There's really no difference at all. So inside of and the reason I'm doing it in OmniTrader and not Visual Trader, because I've had Visual Trader. Visual Trader is running with real time on my other computer. And if I start it up, it's going to kill the real time feed. And I don't want to have to wait for it to reanalyze everything. So that's why. But so we're going to start in OmniTrader. At the top left corner in your focus list, most of you already know how to get here. It's the pencil icon. Inside of Visual Trader, it's still up in the top left above the focus list, but you'll have this yellow bar. And then to the right of it will be the pencil icon in Visual Trader. So if you're following along there, that's where you'll find that. So let's go ahead and click on the button and open up our OmniScan. Now, a lot of the features inside of this are very similar to the features that we had in MarketScans. And the reason being is MarketScans was built off of the architecture of OmniScan. So a lot of it's going to be similar. Some of the differences you'll see between OmniTrader and Visual Trader is the group listings. So as you create a scan over in the focus list, it will be broken up by groups. Inside of Market Scans, it will have the ability to click charts at the bottom left. But really, you know, outside of that, the functionality is pretty similar. Of course, Market Scans allows real-time scans, whereas OmniScan inside of Visual Trader and OmniTrader are for your end-of-day scans only. So we're going to cover some of the basics here. Let's go ahead and minimize all this. So as you can see, just based off of a normal installation, you're going to have quite a few options. And depending on what plugins you have or which additional services you have, so if you have the Zax industry groups, you're going to have a lot of things that other customers won't have. Your customers are going to have like industry groups, but the Zax groups are the new updated ones. The ones in the industry group tab are the ones from the service we were using years ago, but they are still in there because some people still use them. Outside of that, you'll have Nirvana list. These are going to be ones that we have created for specific types of markets. We'll go over some of that here in a moment. If you have plugins that have any type of scans, you'll find those underneath the premium subscriptions. For example, we have pattern scans, position trader, swing scans, MS16, which is a strategy. There's different scans that you can use in there. Now, the one difference that you're going to see as we're going through is scans that we've created proprietarily for plugins, you're not going to be able to see the criteria. Scans that we created for everybody, you're able to go in here, but you're not able to modify them. And then ones that you create, you'll be able to edit and modify and see everything. So inside of OmniScans, it gives you a couple of different things, different options at viewing your lists. So before we jump into the actual OmniScan, we're going to take a look at the My Symbols list. Because one question I always had when I was taking support calls is, how can you make secondary or second, third, fourth, fifth symbol list? So what you can do is you can right click on My Symbol list, create a new one, and give it a name. So we'll rename this. This is my new list, and let me move the GoToWebinar. And then if we hit close, what that's going to do is that's going to populate a new My Symbols list. So it's not a scan, but it's a way for you to add stocks that you're wanting to watch into a separate group. So you might say, if you're following along in the mornings when either Jeff or Steve or myself are talking about the different groups or the different stocks, and you wanted to find or put them all in a particular group, you could use this. And then anytime you're in the My Symbols list, anything that you add will go into that particular list and not into your My Symbols list. It happens to be in that one as well, just because I chose Apple. But so this is a secondary list that can hold a separate group of symbols outside of your normal one. So let's get back in here. Real quick before we get going too far, are you guys hearing this okay? I have someone in here saying that they're not hearing the sound, and I just want to make sure before we go too far that you guys are able to hit. Okay, thanks. Thanks, Chris. Thanks, Don. Thanks. Everybody hears it. Great. Okay, I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't sitting and talking to myself, because I do that quite frequently as well. All right, so that's the My Symbols. All right. You can do similar things with custom groups, where you can create a group scan or a group symbol list inside of that. It's very similar to your My Symbols list. But where we're going to focus the majority of this is going to be on creating simple scans that you can use. I'm going to follow pretty much what Angela had done in the first one. I'm going to cover how you can use scans that we've built and be able to go in and modify them. And then if it's needed, we can go and import new ones in there as well. So the first thing, if we're going to create a new scan, you're going to go to the custom scans list and just right click. And if you had another scan in here, you can right click in here, and there's some options in there. You can back them up. You can move it to a folder. So instead of my custom groups, if we wanted a new folder, we can say, this is my, oops, I need to right click and not just start typing. So this is my trade strong scans. So if I wanted to, I could create a new scan in here. And this is going to be tutorial from 07-2020. So this is going to be the one that we're going to be working on. You can also right click here, new scan, and you'll have the same type of behavior. So clicking on the tutorial, I'm going to have to move the GoToWebinar stuff. We'll move it right here. The first thing that you're going to see is once you've done that is that your count is zero. It doesn't have any starting population. So we need to remedy that. So you can click on add over on the right. That's going to open up this small little dialog box. And you can add any of the indexes. You can add any of your standard list. You can use any of the exchanges. You can use any of the industry groups, exchange traded funds, the new Zacks groups. So you can select them, and in each one of these, it has all of the listings of all of the stocks that are available. So depending on what you're doing for your particular trading needs, you can go in there and select only what you need. So let's say we wanted exchange traded funds, and we're going to do major sector ETFs. We could add that in there. It will quickly go through and scan and bring only the stocks that are part of that or meet that criteria. Now, in the starting population, you'll notice that the count over on the right, let me use the pencil. The count, oops, almost got the pencil or the spotlight. Oh, maybe I do. No, it's not there. Well, it says that it's there, but it's not. So the count over here on the top right says 61. However, in the center, it says 30. And over on the left, we only have 30 stocks. That's because down here is an option that says select the top 30 stocks. So if you wanted all of them, you could do 61. And then that will go through. And when we apply it, it will go through and add the rest of the stocks. Now we have all 61 stocks in that list. Now, depending on what you're doing, you might not want all 61 stocks. And you might be asking, well, how does it determine which 30 or 61 stocks or however many stocks you have in your list, how many do you, or how does it determine what to put in there? What's the top? It's going to be sorting it based off of this criteria right here. And if you don't know how to read this, don't fret. Here shortly, we will be going through and writing some of this out, and hopefully that will help you understand what you're writing a little bit better. But this is basically saying the average close price over the last 10 periods times the average volume over the last 10 periods. So it comes up with that calculation, and then based on the ones that have the highest value is going to be the top 31 stocks. So the top 31 in that sort value, or 30, in that sort value is going to be what's listed in your scan. All right, so I'm going to come over here, and I don't want to start with 61, and I don't necessarily want to start with ETFs, so I'm going to delete that. I'm going to click add again, and I want to go to some of the bigger groups of symbols so that we have a good segment of stocks that we can look at. So let's go in here. We'll do the S&P 500. Let's add the Russell 2000 and maybe the Dow when it comes up. The Dow 30. Now, you saw it pause there for a second. It's because it's going out and it's scanning and pulling all of the stocks into the list. So if you add, you know, 1900 and really the only limit to this is your computer. I mean, if your computer can handle 37,000 stocks or, you know, stocks, ETFs, mutual funds, you know, not mutual funds, I don't want to put that out there. You can't put that in scans, but ETFs. I mean, you can really pile it on if you're really looking for that criteria, but just know that the more you add, the longer it's going to take for it to go through and process, which if you're doing it at night and have that time before the session opens the next day, a lot of people are okay with that. But if you're just looking to get good candidates for the following day, you know, trying to keep it manageable is probably the best. So in this case, right now, we have a starting population of 2,600 about. I'm hitting apply to let this go all the way through. So we can say I want the top 3,000 stocks. And now it will put all of the stocks in the focus list. This is going to take just a moment for it to go through. And again, you're not necessarily going to want to do this, but we have 2,444 stocks in here. So that's basically the stocks from every one of those exchanges listed there. So to make this a little bit more user-friendly, I'm going to drop that back down to 30, just showing kind of the functionality. So now, once you have that starting population, you know what you're looking for. We can start to add in some criteria rules. Okay, so criteria rules are going to be what the software is utilizing to scan and find the opportunities that you're looking for. So if we come down here to the bottom right, you see fund, tech, reset, and clear. Oh, that's the wrong side. Sorry, it's at the bottom left. I was like, I don't remember a reset and clear. That's because that's for the sort value. It's library, fundamental, and technical. So it's right here in the center, right here. So if you click on the library, this will open up a library criteria rule. And again, for some of you, this might be, you know, over your understanding or over your want. Just know that as we go through this, some of the more technical things that we're doing, you do not need to use in order to make OmniScan work and be productive for you. We've already done a lot of the hard work for you, okay? So we click on the library. This is going to open up technical rules and fundamentals. Now, the fundamentals you have to put in yourself if you want them. We do have a fundamental tab down here which has presets, but for the criteria rule library, we have some options in here. We're not necessarily going to go through all of these, but basically you have some momentum, turning, volatility types. Some of these actually might be pretty good in current market. So let's see. Volume increase. Let's stick with technical for right now. At the end, we'll jump in and we'll play with some of the library functionality. Next thing you have is the fundamental criteria. Now, if you're into trading fundamentals, we have almost every option you can imagine in here. You're going to need to know a little bit about the fundamentals in order to really get a good scan criteria. If you don't know the beta 36 month or what the values mean, you know, you might be just scanning out possibilities because of a lack of understanding. I'm also going to show you a place that you can find some of this information here in just a little bit, but you can go in, you can set it for a range, you can set it for a specific, you want it to be below a certain criteria or above, and that opportunity is available on each of the fundamental criteria scans. So let's close out of this. We're not going to use the fundamental. We're going to be using technical because OmniTrader is a super powerful technical analysis tool, although it's good at fundamental and everything else as well. But my favorite part is the technical portion of it. So when you click on technical, this is where a lot of people who don't know Omni language or are not familiar with coding start to get a little bit nervous. And it's rightfully so. It can be a little bit nerve-wracking if you're not sure what's going on. So let's take a look at this window a little bit to start with and see exactly what we have going on here. So this is the formula builder. This is going to have hundreds of pre-configured functions that we've already put in to help you create a logical path to get the stocks that you want. Okay. So up here at the top, we have some operators. You have the plus, minus, you know, all these map functions, greater than, less than, and some statements for and or, so you're building your statements. Over on the right side, and we're going to get into all of this, so just be patient and let's follow along and just try to get an understanding of where everything is, and then we'll use some of these tools to build something. Over here on the right side, we have the building blocks. Again, these are all the functions that we've built in to OmniTrader and Omni, not into OmniTrader, but into OmniLanguage and OmniScan for you to use. If you use a dropdown, you'll see that you have all, you have criteria libraries, which we just talked about, fundamentals, which we just talked about, indicators. So this is going to be about 100 standard indicators, and then any plugins that you have will also be added in there if they have indicators that you're able to utilize. Market breadth, basic math functions, Omni language. There's only one thing in Omni language, and it's for tick size. Some pricing data, so you know your high lows, volume, last price types of things, and then time. And this is more for maybe you don't want your scan to take into account the first 30 minutes of the session. You could come in here and say, after the session opens for 30 minutes, then I want my criteria to start looking for, you know, whatever specifics you're looking for. So that's the time function. For right now, we're going to go up here and select all. And when you have all, it literally has all of the functions in there. Now, if you had OmniLanguage, say you're working with marks, indicators, or you know, you have some OmniLanguage code that you've written, as long as it's compiled, you'll be able to utilize it. Now, it's not going to show it in the list, but you will be able to tag it. So if now Rhino Summary doesn't have any kind of functionality for scans, but if I did, I could use this and say, hey, I want it to be whenever it's above 10, it will find the stocks that on my scan. If it's above a value of 10, it would give us the value of those. Okay. All right, so let's get back to more of the basics real quick. So what I'd like you to do, if you're following along and don't have a lot of understanding about this, I would like you to insert long names and insert parameters down at the bottom. By default, the insert parameters are going to be there, and the check will be out of the long names. What this is going to do is it's going to, instead of using something like C, which represents close, it will actually put close in your code, and it makes it a little bit more English or readable to the human eye. Okay, so we're going to add that in so that we have it. Now, for right now, we're not going to necessarily add any code of our own. We're going to be using the functions that are available over here on the right side. So I know that I'm looking for the average volume, say over 50 periods, is going to be greater than some value. So what I can do, I keep trying to resize this, but it's not letting me resize this window so you can see it all. But what I did is I clicked anywhere in here and I typed AVG, or you could type average, and it will take you down to the average. So let's say I'm creating that scan, like I just said, an average volume over X number of days is greater than some other function. So I want to start with this. All I need to do is double click, and you can see that it says average 14. Now, before we go too far, I want to show you what it's going to look like if you don't have insert long names. It will say AVG 14. Both of these do the exact same thing. It's just shorthand if you're not wanting to, if you're coding it yourself, so you don't have to type it all out. But yeah, that's all it is. Or if you're wanting to follow along with what you're doing and be able to visualize what you're doing, this actually, or this helps you visualize what it's doing instead of trying to figure out what some of the shorthand functions are. Okay, so now we have an average of 14, but what I'm wanting is the average volume over periods. So I'm going to delete this real quick, and I'm going to show you how you can figure out exactly which parameters are available for each one of these functions. So I'm going to hit Shift 9, which is your parent, so open parent. And what happens here is you get a small IntelliSense, well, it's not so much IntelliSense. IntelliSense auto-populates code as you're going. This is kind of a notification of what you can use. So you can see that it says one of two, average days back. So the days back is going to be number of bars. So the 14 that we had originally is going to be 14 bars it's going to use in that average. If we use the drop-down right here, oops, you can see that it now says average the data you want to use and the days back. So this is an important differential between the two. So in my case, I said I wanted to use the average volume of something versus just the average. So let's type this in. So I want the average of volume. So I can type V, or I can type in volume. And it says that I need to do a comma and then the number of days. So I want 30 days. Now that's no different than this. They're exactly the same. They're saying the average volume over 30 days. Now it doesn't have to be volume. It can be another indicator. It can be closing prices. It can be it can be any kind of data value that's available inside of OmniScan. It can be used for that criteria. So in this case, I'm saying I want the average volume over 30 days to be greater than, so I use the operator up here, we'll say 750,000. So I'm going to pause right here. I'm going to look at the questions, and before we go on, because this is kind of the beginning, I just want to see if there's any questions. Paul has a question. It's actually a couple of minutes ago, but it's still on the screen, so I'll go ahead and answer that. It says, why is the Standard & Poor's 502 stocks? The reason is the stocks in the S&P 500 will fluctuate sometimes. And as there's still data for some of the older stocks, or as they've moved to new tickers, or, you know, various different things that can go on, they can be left behind. Now, they do get corrected automatically. It's not something that you're going to have to use. And if there's no current data on it, even if there is a chart, it won't be included in there. You'll also notice that the Russell 2000 is 1986. It's not 2000, and it's the same type of thing. Yeah, James, I will answer that question in just 2 seconds. Actually, I'll answer it right now because I thought that it was actually on this window. So James is asking if we can give a description or an explanation of compile. So basically, whenever compile, when we say or utilize or use the word compile, it means that the computer is going to take the new code that we've put in and it puts it into a language that the computer understands. So if we're looking, and I don't want to get super into code or anything, but if we're looking at this right now, you and I, and even somebody who doesn't know code, can probably look at this code and say, I kind of understand what that says. Okay, so it's an average. It looks like it's averaging volume. I don't might not know what the 30 is, but whatever value, I want it to be greater than 750,000. Well, that's fine if you and I or anyone on this webinar are reading it, but what the computer sees is something, you know, like this, some form of binary or computer machine language. So what happens is when you compile, and that's going to be the same in Omni language or OmniScan, or if you're doing a quick indicator on your chart, what it does is the compiler or the builder or the tool will format this into something that the computer can understand. The computer doesn't understand this. It doesn't know what this is. So there's a machine or a compression or compiling tool in the background that says, okay, so average, this is actually what it means, and it breaks it down into a computer, a language that the computer can actually understand. So that's what the compile is. Tim, yes, I will answer that question when we get a little bit further into this. But yes, you can. So I'll go over that here in a moment. Okay, so again, that's kind of an easy understanding of what's going on. Now I'm going to hit apply. It's going to go through. It's going to scan the 2,440 stocks, and it's going to come up and tell us exactly how many stocks meet our criteria. So it's going to go through that. So out of the 2,400 stocks, 1,260 of them meet the average volume over the last 30 periods or 30 days is greater than 750,000. That's great, but obviously 1,260 stocks is still quite a bit for us to go through and try to analyze and find good trading opportunities and things like that. Well, that's easy enough. We can come back down here and click on technical or fundamental or criteria, library, any of them, and choose another one. So now let's say, well, the market has, you know, really been down, but it's had a little bit of a bump coming back up. Maybe we can say, oops, I said I'm not going to code this, sorry. I want to find the moving average, stocks that are above a certain moving average. So I can come over here, make sure that I'm on all, just click in here and type in move. You can type in moving average if you're a fast typer, but by the time you get to move or MOV, it will find it. So we'll double click here. And then this is saying, well, it's a moving average is over 14 periods. And this notation here is talking about it's a simple moving average. Now, again, you might not want to use simple, but you might not know everything that's available to you, right? So if you delete those and start with a paren, that's shift 9 on your keyboard, it will open up the window. So now we can say, okay, so this is a moving average, the periods, and then the type. Or you can do data, periods, and type. So again, if I really wanted to get, you know, into it, I could say, okay, I want the moving average of the volume over 30 periods, and simple, okay? Oops, help if I... So now it's going to be the moving average of the volume over period over 30 periods, and I want that to maybe be above 50. And then we hit apply. That might not actually filter out anything because 50 is probably extremely low. Let's say the average volume is 350,000 would be a more logical thing than 50. I was thinking like a 50 period moving average when I typed it out, but when I thought about it. So the average volume, that still comes out at 1250. So we're going to change this around. Instead of going for volume, we're actually going to do the actual moving average. This is a 50 period moving average is less than, oops, I'm sorry, I say I'm not going to do it, and then I do it. So I click up here, is less than, and then I'll hit space, and I'm going to come back over here, and I don't know, let's say we want close. So we type in close or hit C, and then that will open it up, and let me get back into that. I hit the wrong key. I hit enter, so it tried to compile what was there. So we're going to do C, and instead of hitting enter, which hits OK, we're going to do C for close. So now the average, the moving average, the simple moving average of 50 is less than the close. Now we'll hit apply. It will go through, and now it's found 127 stocks that have a moving out or the average volume of 750,000, and that the moving average, the 50 period moving average, is less than the close price. So that means that the price of the stock is still up above the 50 period moving average. And you can see over here what stocks we have. We have Amazon, Microsoft, some names that you might not be surprised about. I'm actually kind of surprised there's that many out of that list. So now we've created that scan. Let me take a look, see more questions coming in. Let's see, Mark is asking, can you please show the shift click for snap in the library? Shift and what? Okay. So let's go back in here. We'll add another one. Here's the snap. Okay. So Mark is asking, this one's a little bit different. Okay. You'll notice that this one has two parentheses. It doesn't have any actual values in it. So if you do that, like we normally did, it just says, hey, that's not something that I can do. Now, I'll show you the reason why. And you're going to run into some, oops, I don't want to do that. I just want to, there we go. You're going to run into some that might have that exact same setup there. And what that means is that the function inside of OmniTrader, or in that case, the Snap Analyzer tool, the function itself didn't have any additional parameters. So it's using a set data set as far as that goes. Now, what we can do is we can come into our chart. We can right-click and add indicator, and then go to Snap Analyzer. And you have five indicators that you can use. Now, we're just going to add all of these, and as we go, you're going to see what I mean. So the Snap Analyzer group strength. Well, it doesn't have any parameters as a color option. So we'll go in here to Snap Analyzer Market Strength. This one has a line that you can't modify. It's just the line. So it also has no parameters outside of the symbol. So it has a market symbol. I am adding these for a particular reason. So we'll go back in here and add indicator. And we're going to go back in and do SA Strength again. This one has a line, but no actual parameters that you can modify or change. Tradability. Again, you'll notice no parameters. Now I'm going to show you one that has a parameter for everybody else. So let's come in here and go to a MACD. So now this one has parameters. It has variables that we can change and say, you know, we want scans that look for in between the short periods and long periods. So we would be able to find things that fall within that range, and that was completely hypothetical. The Snap Analyzer doesn't really have any of those. Now, what you might be able to do, and I haven't tried the Snap Analyzer, so we're going to be going through this kind of together here. I'm going to pull this over so I can see the code over here. Sometimes what you're able to do, and this is a little bit more advanced, so if you're not ready for this, that's perfectly okay. I forgot what I named it. I named it with a date. Oh, here it is. Trade strong. Put it in its own group. That's why. Okay. So let me minimize this so we're not confusing it. Here's ours. So let's say I want to add another one. Now, I know that the Snap Analyzer has something in there, but it's really not giving me anything that I want. And that's the Snap Potential. So let's take a look here. We can do SM, STR, and you'll notice that it gives us the same thing. It knows what this is, but also this doesn't have any parameters. But maybe we can do something like, we could do something like this, where we know what it uses just because we've plotted it. So it's looking at the snap strength versus the S&P. But now we can try it with this. And it looks like it's a 0 to 50, so I can say is greater than 50. Now again, this might not work. I don't know if all of it works. So this is saying there's invalid arguments. So that means that the S&P is hard-coded and that it can't be changed. But now if we apply it, it should go through because now it's a criteria. It's this indicator. When it's above 50, it will meet that criteria. So we can hit OK. That was kind of a long way around Mark saying that it doesn't have any parameters. So out of these 120 stocks, none of them have a Snap Analyzer strength of greater than 50. So we're going to delete that one right now. Okay, so that's how you're going to create it, and that's how you're going to identify. Now, sometimes you're going to run into a situation like Mark brought up. It can be custom code, something that, you know, maybe you've gotten from the TradeStrong education or the Nirvana Club education, or you guys have found it on the forum, or you went to, you know, myfavoritestocktradingcode.com website and you've gotten some code and you've built it. Now you can add that in as an indicator and utilize it, but if it doesn't have any parameters or it's all built into that the code that you wrote, it might just be something like your code is greater than some value. Okay. So it might end up being like that. But that's a little bit more on the advanced side, and I probably shouldn't have derailed like that. Okay. So hopefully now you know how to understand what the code is actually looking for, what it means, and ways to get around it. So if you don't know what MOV means, then you know how to insert long names, how to find it from the list, and that goes with any code. So if there's something inside of OmniTrader by default or that we've built, if you don't understand what it is, you can take the breakdown or the shorthand and just type it over here, and it will take you to exactly what it means, and then you'll be able to look at the definition or the long name, and it will give you a little bit more information. Now, I don't want to apply the changes. How about I cancel that? Okay, so I'm going to send you to a resource before we move on to the next part that most people probably are not familiar with. But a while ago, and I'm going to let you know I haven't finished it, but under the education, there is a knowledge base. And if you click on that, I started to put some knowledge base files in here, but you can go in here and there's different articles based on the indicators. So if you find something that you're looking at that you don't know, you can come in here and take a look. So these are the criteria rules. So it breaks down each one of the criteria rules. Inside of the indicators, it goes through all of them and then the data parameters that are available for each one of them. Now, these are going to be for your normal pre-built and indicators. It has not been completely updated, but there, as you can see, there's a ton of them in there. What break down exactly how each one of them are written, the long name, and what parameters are available. So again, if you're just getting into this, or if you've been here for a while and you just want an easy way to look, it's under education, knowledge base, and then there's all kinds of stuff in this knowledge base. So there's also other things that you can find in there, but that's one way that you can go about that. All right, so no problem, Mark. No problem, Don. Gary's asking, what are the combination of keys to show the parameters of the function? So it's not actually a shift. So if we go back in here and we'll edit this, and I'm going to pull ARSI. So what you can do is just delete the code that's there and do a, it's a left parent, so it's shift 9. I'm sorry, I probably confused that when I said shift. It's not like a key combination. It is literally the left parent. So it will look just like that, like you're starting the code. So shift 9 for the parent. And then if it has multiple values, it will have it. If in this particular case for the ARS, it only has minimum periods and maximum periods. So, and it tells you the format too. So sometimes it will need quotes around something if it's a symbol, or, you know, it might need paren within parens. So just kind of pay attention to that. But like this, we can do 15 and 45, and then that will show you that. So that's what that is. So left paren will open up the small menu so that you can get in and see how they're built. Again, that knowledge base also has it. So if you don't want to do that, if you have two monitors and you're building something that's a super quick resource or reference. Okay, now I'm going to move on from this particular example. If you guys have questions, please let me know. I don't mind answering them, but I'm going to move on to the next part, which is just a continuation, really. So now I'm coming over here. Oops, I don't want to be in custom. I want to be in Nirvana list. So you're you know, new to the scans. You've had it for years, but you know, you've really never fiddled with it, but you've seen some of these, and maybe you have an idea of something that would be better or that you could improve on in one of the lists, or you have an option list that you're using, but you want to filter that down. So what you can do is under Nirvana list, standard list, exchanges, or really any of these other ones down here, what you can do is you can find the list that you're doing. Okay, so we're going to start with, let's do all optionable US stocks and ETFs. This has 4,200 stocks. Now, the first thing that I said when we came in here is these lists that we built, you don't get to see any of the criteria. Okay, some of them you do, like the Nirvana list, you can see it, you just can't edit. But all these other lists down here, you can't really see how they're built, because a lot of them are just going to be symbol lists. They're not going to have any kind of, you know, filters or anything in it. But let's say we want to use this one. So what I'm going to do is right click, and I'm going to duplicate list. And this is going to just make a duplicate of all optionable stocks. Oops. Actually, I thought my eyes were bad, but it doesn't. Let me make sure I'm not putting a bunch of them up here. Nope. My apologies. I thought we could pull those ones in too, but oh, no, that one's there. It's putting it, oh, okay. So apparently not all of them. Oh, wait, that was a Nirvana list. That's why. So the standard list, you're not able to duplicate. I apologize. I was about to take you down the wrong thing. I thought you could do it on any of them, but you can only do it on the Nirvana list. So let's go ahead and start. Different example. I'm going to delete this one here, which I did in a rush. So let's say Smooth Movers is fine. Smooth Movers is a good list. It's a really good list. So let's say so this has a total cap of 1.5 million clothes greater than $5. And by now you guys probably can kind of see exactly what it's doing. So you can understand what total cap is. You kind of know what C is. And if you don't, you know where to find it. Average, we kind of covered extensively. So now you know it's the average volume over 60 periods is greater than 300,000. And then this one is a new one. This is a gap indicator. So this is going to be taking the high or the open, the high, the low, and the close. I don't know what these other parameters are. We'll look at it here in a second. Greater than 5. So let's say this is the one we want to start with. So we'll right click. We're going to duplicate. It's going to add our smooth movers list. So this is going to be trade strong smooth movers. And it has the same 1,773 stocks in it. But now what we have the ability to do is come in here and modify. Okay, so total cap, that's fine. But I really don't like $5 stocks. So I want them to be greater than $10. Easy enough. I can go in and change that by clicking the criteria rule and clicking edit to the right. And now it's going to filter our list. So now we, instead of 1,700, we have 428. That's a good start. Well, 300,000 volume with all the selling we've had right now, that's probably going to be a little bit too low. You've seen me use this multiple times. I like it to be 750,000. So 750,000. This is over 60 periods. So this might filter us down quite a bit. It goes through. And we have 229. Now, the gap. I said we would take a look at it. I don't know everything that's here. I don't think anybody, well, maybe Gianluca, Kosei, and Hans do. But I don't know all of the stuff that goes into a gap. So what do? I'm going to delete this. I'm going to use a parent. And now I can see, okay, so the gap has periods, has a value, units, and ATR periods. But it was using this one. So it's using open, high, low, close, periods, a value, the units, and ATR periods. So let's take this, and we're going to put a pin in it for a second. We're going to take a look at this indicator so that we know, because right now, the value, what is the value? That's the 150 right here. No, the periods is 150. The value is the 0.5. I don't know what the value does as far as this indicator. There might be something better that I can use to help narrow down what I'm wanting. So for right now, oops, I just broke the code. No. So let me show you how I broke it real quick. Some of you probably already caught it. I have too many parents in there. So you always need to match. That's probably something that is good to talk about right now. So in coding, no matter what language that you use, you're going to have containers that are going to be either parens or square brackets or curly brackets or, you know, any of these types of things. And in coding, when you start with something, you need to end with the exact same thing. That's how the computer knows that that statement is complete. So anytime you have a parent, you need to have a closing parent. And something that you'll notice, it's a little bit hard to see probably on this monitor, but when you do it on your own, you'll notice that like gap has a reddish hint to it. If you put your mouse to the right of the first parent, it highlights the closing parent. So if you're writing some code out and you're not sure why it's not working, you can break down and go to each one of them. You'll notice that when I have on the square bracket, it now highlights it on the opposite side. So just make sure that you have a single open and closed parent appropriate to what you're doing. I'm looking at the questions here. Can you scan stock options for open interest or open volume? I'm not sure. I'll look at that. I don't think so, because it's based off of our end of day data, and I don't know if those volume we can definitely do, but I'm not sure about open interest. I'll look. Okay, so there's a lot of questions there, but I don't want to get sidetracked. I'll answer all of them, time permitting. It's almost two, so time permitting, we'll do that. But the one that we're working on right now is this. And like I said, I don't know what gap is exactly. I mean, I actually do, but for the example, I want to say that I don't. So let's go ahead and minimize this. I opened this up so I could have a full view. So I'm going to come into OmniTrader. I don't need to know any of this other stuff anymore, so I'm going to delete all. I don't want those. So now if I right-click and go to Add Indicator and then Gap, now we can start to see exactly what's going to be used for that code. Now, I know that for some of you, this is like, oh man, I have to do all kinds of different things to figure it out. Yeah, sometimes you do. Sometimes with coding just in general, you're going to have to do a little bit of research to find out exactly what is perfect for you. So we had talked about the periods. In the case of the scan, it's 150. The value, which we didn't know at the time, was 0.5 points. This is going to be an interesting portion right here. So what I want you to pay attention to is the order that it's laid out, okay? So ATRs, percents, and points, okay? This is going to get into a little bit more difficult coding concept for people who aren't coders. So in programming language, the beginning of a list, so this is a list, ATR, percent, and points, it starts at zero. So this isn't 1, 2, and 3, it's 0, 1, and 2, okay? So we want to keep that in mind when we go back. So we're going to leave it on points, which is 2. And then ATR periods, which is 14, and the same thing with either, or the gap method, up, down, or either. It's going to be the same principle there. As far as the layouts. So now we kind of have an idea. We were talking about value. Well, what does the value do when we modify it? Well, you can kind of see that it alters the way that the curve is. It kind of flattens it out. It's a smoothing mechanism. And again, this is part of the scan. I'm not trying to promote the gap indicator. It's just I wanted to see what it was doing and how it was modifying so that when I go back into my scans, I have a better understanding of what I'm modifying. So, okay. So, edit here. So we had the 150, we had the 0.4, and this one here, we had 1. And if you remember back, it was ATRs and then periods. I don't remember the other one, but this was the 0, 1, and 2. Now, something you'll notice here is the third option that I brought up, the above, below, or either. That's not an option in the code. So that one is not here. But that's what this is. Not knowing exactly everything that it's going to be looking for, I'm going to leave this one the way it is. And then we're going to go in here and let's take a look at this stock list. So in this one, we've copied the trade or the smooth movers. We've modified the values to where the volume is higher, the price is higher to get something that is a little bit more user-friendly when it comes to what I'm looking for. Now, as far as the scan goes, I'm going to set this up the way that our scan was so that we can see how it worked out. So that one was percent and then 5. So in this particular one, it doesn't look like it would have really filtered out anything. Let's take a look and see how some of these are, because the last value was above 5. So that's 7. I mean, there might be some values in here that did filter. Okay, yeah, so this one, it had a filter value of 5. It had to be greater than 5. So that's why these are staying. So let's just take a look at some of these smooth movers. And you know, you want to keep in mind that it's over the last 60 days. So 30 days here, 30 days here. So it's really looking at this period of data right here as far as that scan goes. Okay, so again, I don't know if the scan is better or worse than the original one. It was an example only, and hopefully during this you've gotten a couple of new resources, because I'm sure out of everybody in here, 99.99% of you didn't know about the knowledge base on the website. So hopefully that will help you. I've put in every indicator that's default by from the install in there, so you should have everything. There's also some Omni language if you're wanting to kind of learn a little bit more about the Omni language. It's all in there as well. Not all in there, but a lot of it's in there. Let me go back over here to the questions, and then some of these questions are going to be just slightly off topic, but they all kind of pertain to the same thing. So all right, so Don, Gary, I'm going to come back to you still when I get back in here. Donna saying, can you copy and paste symbols to a new list? So the easy answer, or the simple answer, is yes, you can. You can come in here and say, I want to copy symbols. I just left-clicked, highlighted, right-clicked, and selected copy symbols. And I can go over to my my symbols list. Now, you can't copy and paste symbols into a scan. Okay, so I can't say, you know, I wasn't looking at the IBD50 on the website and copied them, and I want them to run into the scan. You can't do that. Okay, you can't paste it into here, even though it says you can. What you can do is come over here to your new list, right click, paste symbols, and it will add all of the symbols in there. Let's see. Steven is asking, maybe it's too geeky, but if I build a custom list using another custom list as a starting population, it allows me to do a two-level sort. For this to work correctly, the first sort must lie first list must be updated prior to the second list. Are the list updated alphabetically when you run the to-do? Going off of memory, it seems like they are updated alphabetically. However, the easiest way for you to do that or find out is inside of your OmniScan. You can click Update Now, and then watch at the bottom left corner and see how it is. That's the best I can give you. I can talk with Kosei, the data guy, and see if he knows. Gary's saying, I'd love to see a sample results of the premium scan services you offer. Maybe another day. Yeah, we can definitely do it another day, but we can also look at it just briefly right now. Now, the results, I haven't been running them, and they're not necessarily results-based scans. So if you have a chart pattern, or pattern scans, rather, it will find specific types of patterns that are present inside of the charts as of the last data collection. The seasonal scans are going to be looking for seasonal things that are representative of, you know, the seasonality module. Help if I can get it out. Position trader, which is actually a really, really good scan. There's a position trader plugin that's really, really good as well that these are built off of. But yeah, continuation basing and liquid stocks, swing stocks. So yeah, there's no record of them necessarily. These are strictly just stocks that have the opportunities available in them. Hopefully that kind of answers. Let's see. Eric Severance is saying, can I paste a long list of symbols into a group in Visual Trader? Yes. When you right click in the focus list, so if you have a spreadsheet or whatever, you can copy them from your spreadsheet and paste into the focus list. Visual Trader has some more options for you. Visual Trader, you can paste into groups, so it can, let's say Apple, Microsoft, all those, it would put them in a tech group. It will automatically group them out, but you can also put them into a single group if you'd like that as well. That's an option in there. Okay, Gary's saying he understands the concept of them, but he'd like to see some results. Yeah, I'll look at those maybe today after the show and see what I can see how what I can pull together. Maybe tomorrow or Thursday we can have one on that. Let's see. Steven is asking, for gap counter, what is the significance of the O, L, H, and C? What's the alternative, if any? So the significance is open, high, low, and close. So I can't dig into the concepts of the gap counter, but basically it's going to take those values over a certain range and determine what size of a gap that you have. When we were talking earlier last week, the week before, about the gaps, you know, there's a lot of information saying that gaps will tend to fill, and based on the size of the gap, you have a higher likelihood that they will fill. He's asking, is there any different or alternative to the open, high, low, close? Yes. Again, if we go in here, we can type gap, or if you want to come over here, type gap, and that's your gap counter, and then open parentheses. And the other option is periods, value, units, and ATR. So basically, it would just take out the open, high, low, close. So this is what it would look like. You're just omitting that portion of it. Let's see what that would look like. So right now we have 229 stocks. If we take out the open, high, low, close, it took out one stock. So I don't think, based on these parameters, that it's that much of a difference. They might be different stocks, but the fact that it's that close, I don't think that there's that big of a difference. So let's see here. Came in late. Can you show how I get to the screen or get to the symbol list you're showing on your screen? Yeah. So inside of OmniTrader, just this will be real quick. You click the pencil icon up here at the top left. If you're in Visual Trader, above your focus list, you'll have a yellow bar similar to this one, and the pencil will be to the right. That will take you into OmniScan. LD is saying, could also calculate the gap of, say, an index using get close spy, for example, and compare to that symbol. There's a lot of different things that you could add in. Get close, if you're trying to reference something, is a really fantastic tool, and I'm not going to go in really in depth, but say that you want everything to be relevant or work based off of another stock. So you could do get close and then whatever symbol. So you could say this is the closing price of a particular symbol, or as LD said, it could be SPY. So if you're wanting an ETF based off of the index. Actually, I don't know if, yeah, I think you need quotations, I think. It will work one way or another, but you could use this as a value too. All right, so I'm going to wrap up with any last questions in here. And hopefully you found some good information in here. And I know I kind of bounced around just a little bit, but this will be available tonight on the Trade Strong website. So yeah. Okay, so I'm going to do something real quick. We don't normally do this. So I'm going to ask you guys who are attending right now. I was going to do a portion on the indicators that I use on my screen in VisualTrader. If you guys want that to happen now, we can take like a 5-minute break. If you want that to happen now, go ahead and use the hands up. If you'd prefer me to wait until tomorrow, then I can do it tomorrow. And I'll just do a majority. messaged you before or after I gave the explanation. So the code that I gave you on the website, I'm going to be updating. I had taken out a couple of values that I forgot that I needed. And I'm going to need to put those back in. But actually, I'll bring this code up so you can see it real quick. Okay, so basically what this one is doing is I've added in 11 different momentum types of systems. I've added their prime ranges for each one of them. I've done a lot of research on this. I didn't just come up with these numbers. I went through a lot of different sources and found what those optimal ranges on each one of them are. I've given each one of them a value. So as one is happening, it's either going to get a neutral or a buy or a sell based off of what that indicator is doing. Then it takes all of those indicators and it throws it into a bin of value. So let's say out of the 11, I had 7 indicators that had met the bullish and 2 of them that were bearish and a couple of them that were neutral. So it stores those values. Then it goes through and I've added in 14 different moving averages. The moving averages, let me get down here. They range from, those are all still the indicators. They range from a 5 SMA to a 30 to 100 to a 200. So it's giving all of the most popular values of moving averages. And then again, it's assessing a value. Is the price of the stock higher or lower than those values over any given time? Then it takes all of them and it compiles them all together and gives you an overall value. So what this is doing is it's giving you an indication of 11 indicators and 14 moving averages on a single bar. So as we're looking down here on these values, these tall dark green ones right here, that means that all of those indicators have been bullish running up this entire run, including the majority of the moving averages and everything else that goes into it. As it starts to fall off, you'll see that you're starting to see a shift in the moving averages, or I'm sorry, in the indicators and everything that goes into the system. So as it's drawing down, as things are starting to move into a neutral to a selling position, the colors are going to change, and it's market sentiment is basically what it's doing. So it's taking all of the momentum indicators and all of the moving averages and giving you a current market sentiment. Now this one does work on end of day, and in end of day you can probably get a little bit better idea, but you can see that the indicators, you know, it's still, all of the indicators are still lagging, but it gives you a real good indication of the strength and the wellness of the market. As you start to see, you know, coming off the bottom here in the middle of March, you could start to see that the indicators all started shifting right around here, and it's showing continued strength. So as positions are moving higher, it gives you an idea, well, you know, all of those indicators that you normally plot on your screen, they're all saying that, you know, the bullish move is in fact moving, or is in fact real. As this is going through, it works better in long-term time frames just because of the amount of the moving average data that's needed. So it's 200 periods, and if you're running on 5-minute bars, it will often count that as a non-value if you don't have enough data. So normally 15-60 are better on intraday for it, but it gives you a real good overall on the market sentiment. Yeah, Mark was saying, I was looking for an indicator, but I had the system. I was looking in the system as well because I built a system that trades this and the next thing, or it generates the signals, and I was using it in a strategy for those. So that's the reason there. And so that's the market summary. I have a couple of variations of this that I use for different things. This one is an overall, so it's taking the indicators and the moving averages. I also have I forget what the other one is that I have. But this is the one that I'm providing for you. So that's kind of how I use it. And when I have it on the mark or on the screen, what I'm looking for is those moves. So as I'm seeing, maybe I go over to the indexes, and if I have it on, I'll start to see that the shift is happening between a bullish run. It's starting to lose its strength. It's starting to move back down into a light green or vice versa. So we've been in a downtrend on the daily. You're starting to see that there's a shift that's starting to happen. And yes, it is, like, again, it's delayed. It's lag because it's moving averages and indicators. All of them are kind of a delayed movement, but it's showing that there's a complete shift in sentiment as far as the market is going. And I'll use it as I'm going through, just looking for those early kind of indications of a confirmed type of move. But that's, at least you have that and you know what's been on the screen the entire time. Now, the last one is one. This is the one that presented at the bash. Alfife. I had written this a really long time ago. I think 2013, 2014, something like that. I was really into the whole moving averages, and I wanted something that was similar, but kind of modified for my own trading. And I was talking to Al Fife, and he's like, I was helping him out and I was showing my screen or something, and he saw it, and then got that code over to him. And this last year he had emailed me, and he emailed Angela, and he emailed Ed saying, man, all I do is make money on this. I use it trading options. All I do is make money. I'm like 100% almost. So it got a presentation at the bash over it. But ultimately, it's a whole moving average. I have an offset on it, and that's going to be the only difference. Now, the whole moving average is extremely smooth in most cases, and what I'm looking for are the jagged moves where there's an actual shift going on. This is the Dow. It's not a super good explanation or a good example here. On an index, let's see if we can find some. Oops, I need to get around my main charts. It has two color values. The color values really only represent bullish and bearish, and the change in the trend. Right, there it is. Let's see if I can make this a little larger. I don't remember if I, yeah. So the way that Al works or uses it is he looks for the shift, and then he's buying options based on the move. I don't know all the specifics about that, but that's entirely how he's done this. Now, the way that I use it, and I have been auto trading this since the market began its downturn, and for the most part, on regardless of bullish or bearish days, as long as it's like a directional move, this thing is like super fantastic on getting you entries. I mean, on the paper account, I have the results for it, but it's been making like $2,500 a day, just auto trading, using this and the Hearst moving average, or I'm sorry, the Hearst end of day trade plan with market entries, not market on open entries. But it's the shifts are just really fantastic, and really the change in color is strictly that. So this one went a little bit long too. I'm going to get that other code up there. If you have any questions, I'm going to be available, but I am encroaching on market wrap-up, so I will answer these questions right now if you have any, and I'll get this other code up on the website ASAP, as soon as the session is over. If you haven't downloaded it, don't download it yet. I'm going to have some new code up there just in a couple of minutes. If you have downloaded it, I will add in exactly what is needed to change. However, I want to thank you guys. Seems like I've been talking all day. I hope you don't find that annoying, but